Boxing now on four, and this week's rounds in the boys' club's intercity challenge for Henry Cooper's Golden Belt.
Left hand, left hand, left hand. All right.
Seconds out.
Bang, bang, bang. Whoa.
Second round. Time.
They're the champions, all right. The lads from Manchester. Last year in the first series, the boys' club team from Manchester beat everyone in sight. They walked off with my golden belt as well. And now here we are this year in Wallsend Boys' Club on Tyneside, where the boys are getting ready to defend their title.
And this, of course, is the second of our quarterfinals in the 1984 Intercities Boys' Club Challenge for Henry's golden belt. Now, you'll remember we've already seen North London beat Cardiff, and waiting in the wings we have Newcastle and Belfast, and of course Liverpool and Birmingham. But tonight, Manchester start the defence of that golden belt of theirs against South London. Well, there's certainly a tremendous atmosphere tonight here, Henry.
Oh, marvellous, Dave. I mean, it's just like the boxing club nights, I should know, when I was a young amateur. You know, not a dinner jacket in sight. It's just good mums and dads and supporters. Marvellous.
Yeah, that's right. It's just the way it should be. And, you know, you may have been reading recently that the medical profession have been voicing their concern about boxing. Well, what we have here for you tonight is what we reckon is the best, most honest and most satisfying boxing of all. That's boys' club boxing under the very strictest of medical supervision.
Gentlemen, please, ladies and gentlemen, bout number one this evening is a 43-kilogram contest, two rounds of 1.5 minutes and one round of 2 minutes, between and introducing, in the red corner, representing Manchester Boys' Club's Nigel Wilkes.
And little Nigel is just 4 feet 10 inches tall.
And in the blue corner, representing South London Boys Club's Riley Williamson. Wilkes, red, Williamson, blue.
Well, 43 kilograms, that's about 6 stone 12. But although both these lads look so small, they're both in fact 15. And they both want to be professionals. So, the start of our second quarter-final of Henry Cooper's Golden Belt. 9 contests tonight, and this is the first. Riley Williamson of South London, he's the southpaw lad in blue, against Nigel Wilkes of Manchester. And both lads, of course, still at school. Young Nigel. Orthodox fighter, left hand, left foot forward. And as I say, Williamson, a southpaw, leading with his right hand. Williamson got the height and reach advantage, and Nigel Wilkes doing just the right thing. Following in at close quarters, working the way to the body as the bell goes for the end of round one.
You stood about a lot, and you're stepping back too much. Let's have a little sway back.
Now listen, just keep that jab working. Bing, 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 all the time, right? Okay. You're doing well. Okay. Don't get too involved, all right? He keeps hanging on, doesn't he?
Well, yes, good advice. Young Riley must keep this at long range. The bell for the start of round two, then, between Nigel Wilkes of Manchester in red and Riley Williamson of South London in blue. he's a determined little lad, this Manchester boy. He clips Williamson with a good left hand of that. Williamson trying to use his definite height and reach advantage, but Wilkes finding that extremely well. Don't forget Manchester, the defending champions. Young Nigel didn't appear in last year's series, but he's making a good enough start in this one. There goes the bell for the end of the second. What a good fight this is.
We've got a pressure in now this round. Oh, mate. Pick your punches. Left hooks and right hands is wide open for them.
You've got Jeb working, all right? Where you going? Get the word. Go on.
The third and final round, then, between Riley Williamson of South London in blue, Nigel Wilkes of Manchester in red, and already one of the Manchester seconds cautioned for coaching from the corner. Nigel Wilkes fighting extremely well. And at this stage, I'd have him slightly in front.
Go on, Riley!
Astonishingly enough, despite his size, he'll be 16 in August. Well, Williamson putting it all into this round. This is a big round for him and he needs it. Certainly pretty close, could go either way this contest. Williamson having a good last round. A second warning from Gordon Ibbinson. That was for laying on. And literally hurls himself at Wilkes. Has an eye for the referee to see if there's anything wrong, but there isn't. Off they go again. And the bell for the end of the final round of a very hard-fought contest. I think whichever way it goes, it'll be a majority points decision, though.
You want it easy enough for me, son, anyway.
Well, three judges, of course. I'd have thought Wilkes has just got it.
Yeah, I'm sure you have. Go on, son.
Well, referee Gordon Ibbinson draws both boys together. A thoroughly well-merited round of applause and a verdict now from our MC, Keith Darlow.
Ladies and gentlemen, the result of that contest by a majority decision, Wilkes in the red corner.
Well, a majority decision it turns out to be, and it looks as though those first two rounds did it for 15-year-old Nigel Wilkes. He's obviously delighted, and that gives Manchester the defending champions a 1-0 lead.
59-58, 59-57, 58.
And now Henry's
59.
With the winner.
Yeah, I suppose what your opponents usually are taller than you.
Yeah, they always do.
Yeah, yeah. And you had the longer reach to South London boy, Riley, your first one. Yeah, but you didn't sort of make good use of it tonight, did you? You should. So, you mean, you're right. You should have been jabbing. He shouldn't have got near you, right?
No. Yeah.
So what do you think went wrong?
I was fighting him instead of, like, just jabbing him off.
Oh, I see. Yeah, you didn't stick your old boxing there, you know? No. You chased him, didn't you?
Yeah, well, when I'm sparring him, I'm always trying to get to the body because I'm only have to do that with my opponent, so... Yeah. Always go for the body when I'm sparring.
That's a good point. Well, that's very good. That's good tactics. That, because if you're short, you've got to keep busy, and you keep a moving target, and then try to get in close. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think what you both, he's got to do what he done today, and what you've got to do is you've got to get that old right hand jab going, haven't you?
Yeah.
I mean, see, he shouldn't have got near you, should he?
Nah. Yeah.
Anyway, no trouble. You've done well. It was a good little scrap, both of you. Congratulations.
Thanks.
To both.
Yeah, thanks.
Gentlemen, the next bout is a 57-kilogram contest. Three rounds of 2 minutes each round. Between and introducing in the red corner, representing Manchester Boys Club's Darren Connellan. And in the blue corner, representing South London Boys Club's Lester Panzavecchia.
Well, this could well turn out to be one of the fights of the night, because we have two reigning junior ABA champions in Lester Panzavecchia in the blue strip of South London, and his opponent, Darren Connellan of Manchester All in Red. Connellan, of course, we saw in the Golden Belt Series last year. He fought three times and he won three times. Panzavecchia too fought for South London in their quarterfinal against Cardiff, but he ended up by losing to Jonathan Cody, a unanimous points decision there. Now, those of you with us last year will remember that young Darren, a bit of a puncher, won two contests inside the distance. Both these boys, 16 years of age. And Connellan, like his brother Tony, who's also a Golden Belt veteran, is a southpaw. He's a window cleaner, and his opponent, Panzavecchia, still at school. A London boy looking nicely composed at this stage. But he's getting caught now. And he's in some trouble, Panzavecchia. I'm not surprised that the referee is going to step in and administer a standing count of eight. It was a right-hander that started it. Well, we know that Connellan can punch. He certainly has lost none of that ability since last year. Panzavecchia in big trouble and really saved by the bell then.
Yep.
Smooth yourself up a little bit, Lester. He's wide open, that jab. He's working as well down there. So just get that jab poking out him. Fast, fast, fast all the time.
Hook him to the body, hook him to the head. Bang them left crosses over, but come away tight and then come back sharp. Move to your right.
Well, round two then between Lester Panzavecchia of South London in blue, Darren Connellan of Manchester in red. Panzavecchia in all sorts of trouble during round one. Well, he's certainly taking the fight to Canella now as Panzavecchia. It's a brave approach. An excellent short right hook there from Panzavecchia, but Connellan just wades through them. He's a tough lad, this Manchester boy. Now, of course, Connellan's a southpaw, the best counter to a southpaw. The right hand's over the top of the guard. Panzavecchia hasn't tried too many of those. He did once there, but he keeps on getting tagged, doesn't he, the London boy? A better round for him, though, that second round, and he's still very much in this fight. And among the Manchester supporters, Darren and Tony's mother.
How do you feel on a boxing night like this?
Nervous wreck.
Yes?
I think it's marvellous what them two lads have done, though. They've done a lot, you know, for their age and what have you.
What sort of boy is Darren?
He's a quiet, you know, very deep lad.
Yeah.
Tony's a bit more out, but
is he? Darren's he's his brother, yeah. He's both what? Mum's a bit more nervous than I am.
Yeah, I'm always glad that's over.
Well done, well, he seems to be doing all right in this one, doesn't he?
Come on, Darren! Come on, Darren!
You'll see that Connellan doesn't throw too many straight right southpaw jabs. He's almost an American-style fighter, coming and hooking all the time. Got a hand to Panzavecchia, he's not giving up, and he's giving Connellan a real fight. The Manchester boy's face, almost the same colour as his vest now. Well, Connellan getting caught more and more as this fight progresses. If there was a pro bout over six rounds, you never know, you might fancy Panzerbacchia to win. He gets in a good left-hander there. Well, we have an award, as you know, for the best young boxer of the night. We don't have an award for fight of the night. Maybe we should, because this bout really has had everything. What an excellent contest. And the crowd rising to that one.
Cheers, oh.
Well, as the two lads come together, certainly no doubt in my mind that one of the
gentlemen,
best contests we've ever seen on the Golden
The winner
belt.
Of that contest by a unanimous decision, Canellan in the red.
Canellan gets it, and it's unanimous.
The judges scored the contest 60-57, 60-57, 60-57.
So emphatic and uniform scoring for Canellan by the three judges, who each award 20 points to the winner of every round. It's South London 0, Manchester 2, and Henry's with the loser.
The kid was strong, but I felt too knackered.
Yeah.
I'll never like that.
Yeah, I watched the first two rounds of it, and he was a pretty busy fight, wasn't he? He was slinging punches to head and body.
He's fitter than me.
Was he?
Yeah. Yeah.
So what do you want to be when you're a bit older?
I'd like to turn pro.
You'd like to turn pro? Yeah. Well, you move nicely in the ring, you've got a good left jab, but I think what you've got to do is go in the ring always 100% fit, you know, give yourself a chance, because if you're never 100% fit, you're not giving yourself, you know, the chances what you deserve. So that's the only thing, mate. Look like something, you do all right.
To each of the venues that we'll be attending in the next few weeks or so, Henry Cooper's inviting along a special friend of his from the world of boxing. Now, we've already met Charlie Magri, former world flyweight champion. Tonight we're going to meet someone also a former world champion, and his name is Alan Minter.
Now, it was a few years ago since I was an amateur. What sort of memories have you got of your amateur career, Alan?
Well, basically from the schoolboys, you know, because, you know, boxing is like stepping stones. You always want to be the ABA champion. Mm-hmm. But my first remember of the amateurs was to be a schoolboy champion.
Yeah.
I never ever done it.
No, no.
To be then to be a junior ABA champion, nothing ever happened.
Yeah.
Then I managed to win the ABA middleweight title as a senior, right. but a great life and a great career, really, you know. Enjoyed it very much.
And what would you say to the boys, any of these young lads who are, you know, contemplating turning pro? What would you say to them?
Well, I would say, you know, if you're going to turn pro, make sure you have a fair and a long and a good amateur career.
Mm-hmm.
And when you turn pro, you don't turn pro right at the bottom, you turn pro halfway up the ladder. And just, you know, believe in yourself and train hard, and hopefully that one day you'll be able to be like a Henry Cooper or Anna Minter.
Well, here are a couple of potential Coopers and Minters. Spencer Guarnier of South London in blue against Carl Harney of Manchester in red. We're in the first round, and that's Guarnier's dad. Oh, what a lovely left-hander. Harney doesn't know what day of the week it is. Absolutely rocked by that punch. I'm surprised that referee Gordon Ibbinson didn't administer a standing count there. He was hurt, the Manchester boy. He's caught again. Two left-handers right to the side of the head. There's only seconds to go now to the end of the round. And Harney probably saved by the bell. Well, we'll be back, but meantime, South London seem on course for their first win, which they certainly need. Well, most of us thought the young man in red, Carl Harney of Manchester, would have been knocked out or stopped by now, but here he still is. We're in the final round of his contest with Spencer Guarnier, who's wearing the blue of South London. No one possible doubt in my mind, has Guarnier perhaps punched himself out in those opening two rounds? Well, we shall see in the next few moments. Harney's certainly got a lot of work to do. He's already collected a public warning. Heaven alone knows how he managed to avoid a standing count when caught with a beautiful left hook in round one. South London supporters getting a bit head up about Harney holding Guanyer around the back of his neck, and the referee agrees. Well, I think that just about settles it for Harney. A second warning. Well, he came back to catch Guanyer well then. But he gets tagged, and it's by that left hand again. That certainly slowed Harney up. Again, the bell may come to his rescue, though. And indeed it does, but I'm sure London have scored their first victory thanks to Spencer Guanyer, who, although not yet 17, has a baby son.
Not to worry. Always on the top, when you get to the top, you just blow it, don't you? Hey, don't put it behind you now. All right.
The winner of that contest, by a unanimous decision, Guanyer in the blue corner.
Guanyer's got it, and it's unanimous. And that puts London right back into this quarter-final against the reigning Golden Belt champions from Manchester.
53-60, 55-60.
South London 1, Manchester 2, and 6 bouts to go.
Well, an opportune moment, perhaps, to consider the boys' club where we're boxing tonight. And let's start with the police.
Every breath you take.
Yes, Sting, lead singer with Police, rock idol, sex symbol, the most distinguished old boy that Wall's End Boys Club has produced.
Every single day.
Today, Sting's worth a reported 20 million, but here in Wall's End on North Tyneside, a lot of youngsters are earning absolutely nothing. Wall's End used to mean coal and shipbuilding as well. George Stevenson developed the first steam locomotive to haul coal down to the local loading staiths, and the Mauritania was built here and launched in 1905. Well, sadly, the coal's all worked out now. The last colliery in Wall's End, the Rising Sun, closed in 1969. Shipbuilding and ship repairing are both in recession too, bringing memories flooding back of the jobless 1930s. And those are the states of affairs from which boys' clubs, sadly enough, are formed. Here at Wall's End, there are 1,000 members or so, and they take part in judo, table tennis, cross-country running, and soccer. And as for boxing, well, the Northeast has been producing great fights and great fighters for the past 100 years. In the 30s, there were champions with evocative names like Seaman Tommy Watson, and cast-iron Jack Casey, the Sunderland assassin. But the fight game declined when life offered softer options. At St James's Hall, one of the great fight venues in Britain, let alone the North East, boxing lost out to bingo. And then the hall itself was knocked out when bulldozers moved in. But the line of good North Eastern fighters continues. Brothers John and George Feeney are current British champions. And here inside the club, well, even boxing struggles. They don't even have a qualified ABA coach. Well, you never know. All that might just change after tonight.
Well, the third and final round then between Reuben Fuller of South London in blue, Des Robinson of Manchester in red. The South London boy took the opening round. The Manchester lad took the second. So, an awful lot depending on this third and final session. That a slip, not a knockdown. Well, Robinson getting through with that jab of his, but he does get caught when he comes in close, doesn't he? Gets in a good left-hander there, that hurt. That hurt Reuben all right. Reuben Fuller in a little bit of trouble, forced to hold on. I think that more tiredness than anything else But the South London boy really under siege now. He hurls his gun shield, misses me by a fraction, no hard feelings, Reuben, but I think you've lost that contest. And I wonder what Henry Cooper and Alan Minter make of it.
Oh, you reckon the Manchester, the Red Bull.
Manchester kids got it, yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of that contest by a majority decision, Robinson in the red corner.
Well, it was only a majority decision in the end, but the right winner, no doubt about that. There's Robinson.
The judges scored the contest.
Shorts up another 59, victory for Manchester.
60, 58, 58,
3-1 then, so lots of pressure now on the next London boy, Dennis Middleton.
Yeah. Now, where do you come from?
Bellingham.
Bellingham?
Bellingham, yeah.
Now, you're not pulling my leg, are you?
No.
That's where I used to come from.
Yeah, I know.
You never ever see me, though, did you?
It's too young, then.
Yeah, no, you're not having a go at me there, are you?
No, not really.
Well, how time flies. Henry Cooper, now 49. Young Dennis Middleton, though, just 18. He comes to the ring with his team 3-1 down. And here's the boy he's got to box.
Paul Fennelly.
And if you want your carpet fitted, Paul's your man, because that's his trade.
And in the blue corner, representing South London Boys Clubs, Dennis Middleton. Fennelly red, Middleton blue.
So the cheeky chappy, the London apprentice bricklayer, Dennis Middleton in blue, Paul Fennelly from Manchester in red. Both these boys 18. Paul Fennelly, the Manchester lad, appeared in the semi-final against Belfast last year. Won a unanimous points decision against Billy Crawford and also picked up the Best Young Boxer of the Night award. But it looks as though he's drawn a tough one against Dennis Middleton. And South London really need a victory to get back into this quarter-final. He's an experienced lad, is Middleton. He's got a whole fistful of London Feds Championships under his belt. And he's also been a junior ABA finalist as well. Well, I scored that to Middleton.
Bring that Jeb back into work, all right? That's your measure. All right? Otherwise, you're going to start wasting them hooks and throwing them away, OK?
Don't forget that left hook up that belly. He's open for it, because he's holding his hands wide.
I ain't going to tell you no more, because you're boxing brilliant, all right?
Twos and threes, them jabs. Twos and threes.
Dennis Middleton of South London in blue. Paul Fennelly of the reigning Golden Belt champions, Manchester, in red. While Manchester went all the way to the title last year, worth remembering that South London suffered an embarrassingly one-sided 7-2 quarter-final defeat against Cardiff. Trying to settle, but not altogether succeeding. George Brignoli telling Middleton, got to step back when he calls break. Now that's more like the Fennelly we knew. Some classic left jabs as the bell goes for the end of round two.
On this last round, you've got to finish this step. All this round, you've got to work like you finished that last round. Yeah, look, I've made you win two rounds, but you've got to make sure it's all right. Oh, it's got to be bell to bell this last round. It's very close. Oh, come on.
Well, I agree with the cornerman. It is close, but Middleton may just be ahead. And Fennelly's got some work to do. For holding there, that could cost him dear when the points tally comes to be added up. A lovely left-hand counter from Middleton there. Fennelly only beaten seven times as an amateur. I wonder if this could be defeat number eight. Now this is the Fennelly we know. Jab and move, jab and move. Well, this really an outstanding quarterfinal, isn't it, so far? Fennelly really trying to give it everything he's got in the dying seconds of this third and final round. But is it too little, too late? Out goes Middleton's gun shield, spits it out. Good fight. What another cracking contest. Contest for the judges to work out. For what it's worth, my money's going on Middleton, but you never know.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of that contest by a majority decision, Middleton in the blue.
Middleton's got it, a majority points decision. Doesn't go down that well. Well, I think that's a perfectly correct decision.
The judges scored the contest 58-59, 58-58, 58-57.
I thought I won it, but the way it goes, if the judges think I've lost.
Well, what interests me, you know, one judge scored it a draw. So under the rules, he had to give his decision to the boy who done most of the attacking. And of course, that was the other boy. And that decided it. Quite honestly, I think the first round lost it for you.
No, well, I've always been a slow starter.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And back in the ring, we're in round three of contest number six. Tony Lowes of South London in blue, Ray Kaminsky of Manchester in red. 48 kilograms, these boys. That's around 7.5 stone. Kaminsky is the boy in red, as I say, the more experienced, and I make him slightly ahead. Well, we heard one of the South London boys a little while back saying he didn't feel at his fittest tonight, and certainly they have had a long coach trip up here to Tyneside, but still they're only trailing at the moment by 2-3. Tony Lowes, the London boy, being urged on as the bell goes, and Henry with the most fervent of those supporters.
Well, what relation are you to Tony?
I'm his auntie.
You're his auntie?
Yes.
I thought his mother was there. Where's his mother?
She was. She's gone out. She can't. She's up on the stage. She can't watch them.
Well, how do you think he did there?
Quite well. It's very close.
Yeah, you think it's close. So you're not going to make... You're not going to commit...
No, I never do.
The winner of that contest by a unanimous decision, Kaminsky in the red.
Yes, indeed. And that increases Manchester's lead. Well, two of the youngest young men we're going to see in the ring tonight, both 14. Lawrence Hunt of South London in blue, Sean Egan, the little Manchester South four in red. London looking for a win to remain in this quarter-final. This is the last round, and I think they may achieve it. I've got Hunt slightly ahead on my card at the moment. Sounds like a bit of a budding character, young Lawrence Hunt. When we asked him who his favourite boxer was, not so much as a blink, he replied himself. And his hobbies, in fact, his only hobby, is eating hamburgers. Well, Egan trapped in the corner above our commentary position. Well, I think Hunt probably done just about enough to win this contest. Both these 14-year-olds, they're putting up a really good showing. Manchester boys starting to get rather tired now. And there's the bell. And what a spirited little scrap by these lads who weigh under 40 kilograms, or about 6'4". And I wonder who's won.
I don't know.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of that contest by a majority decision, Hunt in the blue corner.
Lawrence Hunt gets it, a majority decision, and once again, South London right back in this quarterfinal.
58-59, 59-58.
Three, Manchester four now, and two bouts to come. So let's join Henry and Alan Minter again.
If I asked you, like, what the best advice you could give a young boxer or the best tip you could give him, what would it be?
Well, I think the essential thing for any boxer or any fighter is fitness and dedication. And believe in yourself. I mean, it's no good boxing if you're unfit. I mean, when I used to train and I might have skipped out of the gym for a couple of days, my dad used to go potty. He says, "Would you want to get yourself hurt? You know, you've got to be 100% fit. You've got to be right."
So you've got to love the gym, haven't
you? Absolutely. Because I mean, that's the hardest part of training. The essential thing is like believe in yourself and train hard.
Right. The bell goes for the start of the first. Then between Paul Martin of South London in blue, Jerry McBride of Manchester in red. And if Paul Martin seems slightly familiar to you, well, that's because he recorded one of South London's only two victories last season in the 7-2 defeat at the hands of Cardiff. And as if to emphasise his skill, he also picked up the Best Young Boxer of the Night award as well. Tonight he simply must win for London. If Jerry McBride, the boy in red, beats him, well, Manchester will be through to the semi-finals with a bout to spare. Well, Martin throwing a lot of leather, but McBride catching quite a few of those on his gloves. Not that one, though. The end of round one, and I thought Paul Martin shaded it. Now, if Paul here should beat Jerry McBride, well, then the match would depend on the last contest, and that will be between these lads, Norman Collins on the left for South London and Tony Connellan on the right for Manchester.
Well, you two are looking daggers at each other. What's this for? What's all this over?
Well, we had at least one fight already.
Yes?
Yeah. Well,
yes, they have indeed, and I saw it.
Yeah. Oh, and how did that come out?
He won? Yeah.
So you're out for revenge, eh?
Certainly.
Well, he looks a bit happy about it, doesn't he?
We were a good bout last time.
Yeah.
He just had the edge in the last round of fought.
Yeah.
So, close fight, though.
So what you've done once, what you hope to do again?
Yeah, I hope to.
Well, Norman, did you think you spotted any weaknesses in your opponent last time you boxed him?
Yes, I think I had his body.
Yeah?
His body's a bit weak.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. Oh, you've done a bit of homework on the man.
Yeah, yeah. He's studying well.
Yeah. And what do you think the weaknesses of this guy is?
Well, he tired a bit last time. And
did he?
I pressured him last round.
So you're going to be after him, right?
Well, it's looking increasingly as though all may well depend on that last bout, because this penultimate contest continuing to go London's way. round three, Paul Martin against Jerry McBride of Manchester. And McBride has kept his cool admirably, hasn't got drawn into a slugging match, but for me, hasn't done quite enough work in this fight. He's allowed Martin to dictate the pace. Every time McBride throws a punch, Martin comes back with two of his own. Leads with a right there. And the blood starting to trickle from Jerry McBride's nose now. Well, that was a push. And referee Gordon Ibbinson says, don't. Quick wipe down of the gloves for Jerry McBride. Back into action as this third and final round draws to a close. And I don't think there can be too many doubts as to who's going to win this. There's the bell. And I, for one, reckon Martin has kept this quarterfinal alive for South London.
I think you've done enough.
Well, a lot of studying of the cards. Could we be in for a surprise here, I wonder?
The winner of that contest by a majority decision, Martin in the blue corner.
Well, Martin gets it. I'm surprised that it's only a majority decision.
The judges scored the contest 58-60.
But nonetheless, he's given South London their fourth win.
58.
And it's all square now with one bout to come. And what about this promises to be?
In the red corner, representing Manchester Boys Club's Tony Connellan. And in the blue corner, representing South London Boys Club's Norman Collins. Connellan red, Collins blue.
So, four bouts apiece then, and it's all on this. Collins in blue, Connellan in red, and as you've heard, since last year, they're no strangers. These two boys met in the Junior ABA finals in London, and Connellan won. Tony Connellan, like his older brother Darren, a southpaw fighter, and being watched here at Wall's End by his dad and the whole family. He captained Manchester to their Golden Belt win last year, and in 80 amateur contests, would you believe he's lost just seven? Norman Collins, a record equally as good, 49 bouts and won 45 of them. They're both these youngsters really outstanding prospects for the future. Collins, the tall South London youngster, got to use that jab. Didn't really do it in the first round, though. Quite a lot of work for him to do in the second.
Do something, done nothing. You never throw a punch. You win that round, come on, and get right ahead. They'll rob you if you don't. Get right ahead and work.
Now, come on. I made it. Go to work.
Norman Collins of South London in blue. And the reigning ABA junior champion at his weight, Tony Connellan of Manchester in red. Connellan 15 years old, Norman Collins 16. Well, I gave Connellan the first. Now, Collins certainly coming into this fight during round two. He's a strong lad, this Connellan. Collins trying to get his jab to work. Left hanging perilously low. Canellan's just the sort of fighter who can exploit that. You can see how well Canellan tucks up whenever Collins comes in, both hands high. He's taking one or two, Canellan, all right, but believe me, not nearly as many as he would if that defence of his wasn't quite as good. He got tagged with a left at the end, but what an outstanding prospect this boy, Tony Canellan, is. So, Dad and all Manchester willing on Tony, the South London lads hoping for a grandstand finish from Norman.
In and out, in and out, in and out. OK, come on.
Yeah, grit your teeth, let's go. All right? Now, come on. Now, let's do it, boy, let's go.
The start of the third and final round, then, and all depending on it. Certainly it's going to be a really difficult task for Henry to nominate the best young boxer of the night. We've seen half a dozen youngsters who could quite legitimately claim to win that tonight. Collins' twin brother among the crowd. Well, this repeat of the 1983 Junior ABA final turning out to be the most absorbing contest. The South London fans urging young Norman Collins to work. Blood coming from Canellan's nose now. Shoulder streaked with the blood coming from Canellan's nose. And the pair of them punch themselves out as the bell goes. That's got to be the fight of the night, no doubt about it. More important, though, is there any doubt about the result? I personally would have thought Canellan had done enough, but Collins certainly had a smashing final round, and Henry and Allen, South Londoners both, not trying very hard to remain impartial.
Now you start praying.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what. I think we've got this.
Well, a lot of mutual respect between these two youngsters.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of that contest, by a majority decision, Canellan in the red corner.
Canellan does it again, and so do Manchester. Last year's champions through to this year's semi-finals, but only by 5-4. And what a night, every contest going the distance, and 6 of the 9 to majority decisions.
Scored the contest.
Well, I rate that the best 60, boxing we've ever had in Henry Cooper's Golden Belt, and Henry agrees with me.
58.
One last task for him, that's to award this now familiar shield to the best young boxer of the night. So, Henry, who's the lucky young man going to be tonight?
Well, not a tough task, as you say, but I think I've got to just give it to Tony Canellan.
Well, there you have it then. Just to recap, Manchester, the defending Golden Belt champions, have beaten South London. What a close scrap it was. 5-4, the final result. Henry, next week, back down to the deep south, back down to London.
Back to London, yeah, and we've got Liverpool against Birmingham.
Yes, Liverpool against Birmingham it is. That'll be quarter-final number 3. Don't forget that North London and Manchester already through to the semis. Liverpool against Birmingham next week.
And the week after that, we'll have Newcastle against Belfast. So until then, from Henry,
it's keep your left up, keep out of trouble.
Good night.
Good night.
Bond. Time. Dave and I are back down south this week, and it seems half of London as well are packed into this hall in the East End that used to be a synagogue.
Yes, that's right, Henry. Here we are back again at the Arbour Youth Club here in Stepney. Remember, that's where we started off this year's series. The first quarter-final was held here, and the third quarter-final is going to be held here tonight. But before we get underway with that, let's just remind ourselves of the story so far.
In the first quarter-final, North London beat Cardiff by 5-3. Then Manchester, the defending champions, just edged out the other London team, South London, in a 9-bout match by 5-4. Tonight, it's Liverpool and Birmingham. Liverpool, one of amateur boxing's strongest
Welcome
cities,
the
making their first appearance in the Golden Belt.
Competition between Liverpool and Birmingham.
And, of course, Henry's top boxer of the night award, up for grabs as usual.
Ladies and gentlemen, first bout of the evening is a 55-kilo contest, three rounds, 1.5 minutes each round, between, in the red corner, and boxing for Liverpool, Mark Roberts. And in the blue corner, boxing for Birmingham, Martin Concannon.
Well, tonight we have 8 contests. The number of bouts in these matches will vary according to the availability of boxers for fair matching. Here's the first of them, Martin Concannon in blue for Birmingham, Mark Roberts in the red of Liverpool. Both lads still at school, both thinking they might one day turn pro. Well, right away we can see that Concannon, the Birmingham boy in blue, the southpaw leading with his right. Mark Roberts, the Liverpool lad in red, an orthodox fighter. Referee Keith Ellison says keep your head up. Third time in the opening round that Keith Ellison's had a word with Mark Roberts, and here comes warning number 4. So Roberts incurring the referee's displeasure quite a bit during this opening session. Well, a pretty bright first round there between Martin Concannon of Birmingham, Mark Roberts representing Liverpool.
Right, you're standing off him, he's picking you off. Right, get into him, okay? Bucking and moving, right hand, left duke, okay?
Let's get it all together now. Tighten up and pressure him, but don't make a battle. You're making hard work and easy for you, right? So deep breathing now, come on. And relax. Deep breathing, that's it. That's the way, that's the lad. Now you can win this. I want you to go out and win this round, right? Away you go.
Well, contrasting advice from both corners then as we go into round two between Martin Concannon of Birmingham in the blue strip, Mark Roberts of Liverpool in red. Mark Roberts' trainer, Jimmy Fitzgerald, telling him to get stuck in, and Martin Concannon's trainer, Sean Keenan, telling him to jab and move, not to get a battle, a bit of slip there, that wasn't a knockdown. No count. But referee Keith Everson having a look at Mark Roberts' left eye, a little bit of bump above it. That probably caused by heads, not fists. A lot of headwork going around so far. You notice that Roberts had to wipe his gloves. That was to get off any little bits of grit or resin that might be on the canvas. Good overhand right there from Roberts. It's about the best punch he's landed so far. But you can see, can't you, that swelling coming up over his left eye. attention to a shoelace. Not standing on ceremony. He's infinitely more experienced as Mark Roberts. He's had 47 contests to Kincannon's 15. But Roberts in a bit of trouble there, pinned on the ropes as the bell goes for the end of round two.
Don't let him settle down. Keep on tough them all the while, okay?
Don't make a war. I want you to box, 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 and you'll win the fight.
You listen to me now. No, you've got to do it. You want to win it, son. You can still win it. Win it by 2/3 points. Come on.
Make that right hand work for you now. And cover your chin with your other hand, right? And in and out. There you go.
Well, once again, contrasting advice from the corners as we go into the third and final session. The Birmingham boy, Mark Kincannon, in blue, being told to keep it at a distance. Mark Robert, the Liverpool lad in red, being told to get stuck in, work behind the jab, get through the jab, and start working the head and body. Got a bit of leeway to make up, I reckon, Liverpool boy. Doesn't seem in too much discomfort from that swelling above his left eye. That was a good shot, though, the left. Kincannon protests. But he takes the compulsory count anyway. There you see it. Caught him on the side of the head. Slightly off balance. Down he went. Well, that'll certainly give Mark Roberts some encouragement, but I have a feeling he might have left that assault a little bit too late. But we shall see in just a couple of moments, because not too long of this third and final session left. In fact, there's the bell.
You've got to take it like a man now. Right.
Well, dark forebodings in the Liverpool corner, but much more optimism opposite.
Yeah, relax, you're all right. Just relax yourself.
Three judges for each contest, of course, and here comes the decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, by a unanimous decision, Kincannon.
Yes, Kincannon gets it, an encouraging start for Birmingham, who of course were last year's runners-up in this series.
60-57, 59-58.
Well, congratulations to the winner here.
Thanks.
Nice Bennett. How did you find him?
Awkward fight he was.
Awkward boy, was he?
Yeah, fairly awkward, yeah.
So, how did you find him? What, hard to land your punches on him?
Yeah, going down.
Oh yeah, he was ducking a little bit, was he?
Yeah. Awkward.
And what was this? Because you got a couple of public warnings, didn't you?
Yeah, well, it was trying to hit him into the body, trying to bring him down a bit, like, because he's a tall lad. But as I was trying to hit him in the body, he was moving back and just swinging.
Oh, so you got a little mouse on top of your eye there. How did that? Was that a clash of
heads? Yeah,
was it? Yeah, the usual old thing, eh?
Yeah.
You watch a little bit. I think, you know, what you've got to do, you handicapped yourself a little bit there, didn't you? By, you know, you're ducking in and coming in, the referee warned you several times. So that must have took what points away from you. So I think you've got to try, if you can, you know, stand up and get into your boxing a bit better.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, being a nice tall lad, you're using your reach well. You've got to keep concentrating on your southpaw lead, which is good. So,
but back at ringside, we've just heard distinctly less good news from the Birmingham camp, because one of their boys can't box at his weight, so that means a walkover. And instead of 1-0, it's now 1-1, as Richard Edwards takes their blue colours into the ring against Liverpool's Mark Mulville. Well, we're in the first round, and what a bright opening from Richard Edwards. Certainly giving Mark Mulville no time to settle at all, is he? Short of support tonight, even though we're fighting in Stepney. Mark Mulville starting to come back now. Come on, come on, come on, come on.
Well, the end of a very lively opening round. And now, any proud parents who feared poor young Mark Roberts, who got that swollen eye in the first contest, sit back and listen to your Uncle Henry.
Being an old man who's had a few cuts and bruises, I know how to treat them. It's always nice, perhaps, first to slow the swelling. And the thing that slows swelling is coldness. So if he can put a few ice cubes on it for, say, tonight, give it a good ice in with some cubes in a towel or an ice pack, that's a good thing. And then after a day or two, then get hot towels on it and massage it away. And then he'll find that that'll go in a day or two.
Thanks a lot, Henry. And back in the ring, round two now between Richard Edwards of Birmingham, that's the lad in blue, and Mark Mulville of Liverpool. Now, in my book, Edwards took the first, so Mulville in red with quite a bit to do here in round two. Edwards, the Birmingham boy, slightly the more experienced. He's been boxing 3 years and has had 17 contests, compared to Mark Mulville, who's been boxing 2 years and has had 11 bouts. Fairing his attack well, the Liverpool lad. You notice there, hooking to head and body. Birmingham boy right in this fight. He's dropped his pace from the first round, but there was really no way he could have continued that. I give that round to Mulville of Liverpool, and if he gave the first round to Edwards of Birmingham, then it's all square at the end of the second.
It's all on this round. You need a very good man, OK? So what you're doing, he's going to come storming like you did in the first round, OK?
Lead with that right hand. You can't miss him with that right hand. Finish with the left hook. And again, lad. That's it. Stay by. Sits on this one. Let's have you working now. Really working first bit to last bit. Working, Calvin.
Well, the start of the third round then, and the vital third round is going to be two between Richard Edwards of Birmingham boxing in blue, Mark Mulville of Liverpool in red, and you heard Mark Mulville's trainer, Frank Connor, say everything depended on this round, and that's my reading of this bout as well. Remember, owing to that Birmingham withdrawal that gave Liverpool the walkover, it's one bout apiece so far. And Mulville really starting to stamp his authority on this bout now, boxing well. Remember, for all Edwards' aggression, the blows that count are the ones that are struck with the knuckle part of the glove. That's why the gloves have those white bands on them to help the judges see which points are scoring, which blows are scoring, and which blows aren't. He's doing a lot of pressing forward, Edwards, but he's not landing that many clean punches. For his part, Mulville, having his hands full, keeping Edwards off, not landing that many punches of his own. Looking a little bit tired now, the Liverpool boy. Well, what another good contest. Both boys nearly out on their feet there as the bell ends for the third and final round. And I wouldn't like to have to pick a winner of that one. Here comes the verdict.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner by a majority decision, Edwards in the blue corner.
Well, only a majority decision in the event, but aggression paid off for Birmingham, and they now lead by 2-1.
Judges scored for Edwards 60-58, 60-54, and for Mulville 59-58.
Well, it's time now on the programme to meet our celebrity guest of the evening. If you've been with us throughout the series on the Golden Belt, you'll know that to each of the venues, Henry Cooper's brought along a friend of his from the world of boxing, someone who, in fact, has started in amateur ranks. Well, we've already met Charlie Magri and Alan Minter. Tonight, we're going to meet someone who started his career not too far from here, where we are now at the Arbour Youth Club on Stepney Green.
He's a man who started off as an amateur, went to the Olympics, then turned professional, won a British title, European title as well, and went on to become the light middleweight champion of the world. And his name is Maurice Hope.
Well, Maurice, how did you get into this boxing game?
Well, in fact, I had an older brother who came over from England, well, from Antigua.
Of course, I remember.
By the name of Lex Hunter.
Hunter, who was with Jim Wicks, wasn't he?
That's right, very good lightweight.
And
he, you know, found himself at the old boxing club, amateur boxing club, by the name of Repton.
Repton.
And of course, as soon as I came, at the right age of 9, I had a few years to settle. And at the age of 11, he took me by the hand, you know, and let me join the Repton Boxing Club. I've been there ever since.
Well, what sort of fella was you then before you went into boxing there?
Well, you'd call me a teenager delinquent, I would say. That's right. And like I said, if it wasn't for boxing, I might have been maybe like in prison, etc. I certainly would have been on the streets. But because of boxing, it's made me a stable man. It's educated me very much indeed. It's been marvellous. It's been a mother to me.
Can I ask you, if you had to give, say, what, one tip or one little hint to someone, and a young amateur boxer, what would that be?
Well, I always regard boxing as being one of the hardest sports ever, if not the hardest. So, of course, my number one tip would be dedication, more dedication. That is a game that, you know, need all the dedication as possible.
Well, here are a couple of dedicated youngsters. Calvin DeMonte in the blue of Birmingham, Andrew Holligan in the red of Liverpool. Both 16, these lads, weighing in below 62.5 kilos. That's around 9¾ stone, and Holligan the taller of the two. And that was the bell for the end of the first round.
Now get close and work. Your body shots are good. Keep using them. Keep the pressure on this guy. That round is even, Stevens. Right, all right. Hands up, chin down. Put your punches together. No single left hands because he's counting over the top.
Hands up, chin down. Classic advice there for young DeMonte. What will happen? So, Calvin DeMonte from Birmingham coming out of his corner. Hands up, chin down for round two of this contest with 16-year-old Andrew Holligan of Liverpool. Birmingham, remember, leading Liverpool 2-1 in this eight-bout quarterfinal. As we were saying in the first round, the Birmingham boy giving away a little bit in height and reach. And he paid for it then. A big overhand right. Compulsory count of 8. Well, the punch that did it was a big right-hander coming in over the top. And that's just what we heard DeMonte's trainer warning him about in the break. Some blood on Holligan's nose, not a nosebleed, he'll have cut perhaps on the bridge of his nose. And he's starting to press home his attacks to DeMonte now. Well, DeMonte fighting back very bravely. Certainly not put off his stride by that big overarm right that knocked him down for a mandatory count of 8. Gets tagged by another crisper, shorter right hook then. Well, another bright and enterprising round, and for me, Holligan shaded it.
If you won that round, like if the one round each now, okay. Hey, it's one each now. You won the first round, he probably took the second one, but I want you really working through this. Get close and work that. That right hand to the body is great. You can't miss him with it. But as soon as you get the left right hand to the body, you must finish the left hook. Dead open for the left hook after the right hand. Lead to the body first, he doesn't seem to have any defence in it.
The third and final round then, with everything still to fight for between Calvin DeMonte of Birmingham in blue, Andrew Holligan of Liverpool in red. Remember, De Monte's already paid one visit to the canvas in the early stages of round two. Got caught with a big overhand right. Down he went for a mandatory eight. Well, De Monte still getting outreach, trying to find a way past that long left lead of Andy Holligan's. Just like that. Lovely short right uppercut then. The Liverpool boy took it well. Well, once again, this foul going to be very difficult for the judges. We've already had one majority decision tonight. You never know, this might turn out to be another. It's a nice, compact-looking boxer, De Monte. Getting a good shot to the body then. Don't see too many body shots in boys' boxing. All the domain of the pros. Well, that was a corker. And this late flurry might just swing it for De Monte. Landing some good, solid shots as this third round draws to a close. He looks a little bit pained as it ends. Maybe he thinks he hasn't quite done enough. Well, we shall know in just a moment.
Don't show that. It's very, very close. Don't be too disappointed with that, though.
Aye, good boy, won't he? Hey? Aye, go ahead.
Well, a well-deserved round of applause from this capacity crowd here at Arbor Youth Club. As referee Len Mills draws them together.
Winner by a unanimous decision, Holligan in the red corner.
Well, Holligan gets it. And a little bit easier than perhaps he might have expected. And that is Liverpool's first win actually inside the ring tonight.
Judges scored 60-57,
and ties the match score yet again.
60-57, 60-58.
Well, that's the position so far, then, in this eight-bout quarter-final in our Intercities Boys Club Challenge. And a good time to consider this particular boys' club, the Arbor Youth in Stepney, East London.
Those parts of Stepney lying near the docks of Limehouse have long been notorious for their appalling slum conditions and the social evils such conditions breed. Here, probably more than anywhere in England, was an urgent need for something to be done to give the children better leisure conditions.
And there you have it in a nutshell, in the words of an Arbor brochure written some years ago. The whole background, the very reason, perhaps, behind the boys' club movement of Great Britain. Poverty, deprivation and temptation. The social workers and the do-gooders moved in, and it was their clubs that kept the youngsters off the streets. So it was here in Stepney, but the original Arbor Club was formed, not like so many others back in Victorian and Edwardian times, but after the Second World War.
The Arbor Youth Club is Stepney's pride. It is Stepney, born and bred, spontaneous and self-governing.
Those were the words of the present poet laureate Sir John Betjeman. But soon the club's old headquarters became just too dilapidated to use, and their new home, a former Church of England school on Stepney Green, was almost as shabby. It was deserted and vandalised, and the young boxers and others repaired the ravages themselves. By this time it was the young boxers who were providing the backbone of the club, but when the time came for the move, they and the other sections in the club agreed to disagree, and it was the Arbor Youth Amateur Boxing Club that took up residence in the old school. Then, eventually, the bulldozers that were clearing the East End for redevelopment moved in and flattened the building. 3 years ago, the club had to move on, but not too far, just 100 yards away, to a shut-down old synagogue. The once large Orthodox Jewish congregation had either died, moved on, or simply faded away, and the building, once again, was desolate, damaged, and cruelly vandalised. And that's where we are tonight, the Rosalind Green Hall, named after a little girl who tragically died, the daughter of Philip Green, a local businessman who, along with the Sports Council and many others, helped raise the cash to buy this bargain-priced old synagogue. Which tonight, as you can see, is crowded with boxing fans and relations, of all ages and all sizes. A full house then, all ready to cheer on the boys in bout number five. It's between Des Mooney, sadly one of our 3 million odd unemployed from Birmingham, and Dennis Oakes, an apprentice plumber from Liverpool, a 1983 junior ABA finalist. Round one then. Des Mooney wearing blue of Birmingham, of course. Dennis Oakes, the Liverpool boy in red. Both these lads weighing 56 kilos, that's around 8 stone 11, and Oakes supported here tonight by his father, mother and sister. So two good experienced youngsters in this bout. Des Mooney, the Birmingham lad in blue. He's 17, as indeed is the Liverpool boy, Dennis Oakes. Dennis Oakes only lost 3 of the 21 contests he's featured in so far. Mooney's record, almost comparable. He's had 30 bouts and won 24 of them. Remember, no such thing as a draw in amateur boxing. Always a winner. And that, I suspect, half the appeal. Once again, the third man in the ring, Len Mills, son of ABA secretary, also called Len Mills, making his presence felt. The end of the first round then, and Henry is with the Oakes family.
Well, how are you feeling after the first round?
Nervous, but all right.
How do you think he done up there?
All right.
Well, I think he done more than all right, didn't he? I thought he won that round, didn't you?
Yeah, but he's not got himself going properly yet.
Not yet, eh? Oh, no. He's a strong boy, your son, isn't he?
He's pretty strong, yeah.
He likes to come forward all the time.
He definitely won that one.
He's a strong lad, your boy. Yeah, what did you feed him on?
Very strong.
Does he have more than two shreddy weeds?
He has about 3 or 4 of those, I think.
Does he?
Yeah.
Well, he's got a good run in stage, eh?
Well, he hasn't found his reach yet. He's got to settle down. If he settles down, I think he'll do a bit better than he has done so far.
Well, we've got two rounds to go. Let's watch the next one.
I hope so.
The start of round two, then, between Des Mooney of Birmingham in blue, Dennis Oakes of Liverpool in red. Mooney, a losing quarter-finalist for Birmingham in the Golden Belt Series last year. Oakes, 1983 junior ABA runner-up. So both these boys tonight fighting for what would be, in fact, their first ever televised win. And it's Oakes that's certainly making the running so far. Well, a standing count being administered to Des Mooney there. I think that the cumulative effect of Oakes' attack rather than any one specific punch. Scoring well to head and body though, the Liverpool lad, isn't he? Well, the Birmingham boy forced to hold on then. I don't really think he had much option. That's two warnings, says the magisterial Len Mills, and the bell comes just in time for young Des Mooney of Birmingham.
It's the wrong way to box. That's not the way to box, to be dropping down there. If you want to box, the idea is to stand up and box, you know, and to use the moves you're taught.
Yeah.
The way that lad's boxing, folding up all the time.
A lot
like
of respect. You can't blame him. He's on the end of some good punches from
you. True enough, he is on the end. He is receiving some good punches, correct, he is.
He damaged his palm, lad. Pull him out. He's hurt his hand and pull him out.
Well, it looks as though Dennis Mooney is perhaps going to be pulled out of this fight with a damaged hand. Doesn't seem too keen on going on, does he? You can see him nursing his hand there. No sense in aggravating that injury further. And I don't think this fight's going to continue.
Is it over? I think the referee stopped it.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mooney in the blue corner has retired with a damaged hand. Oakes in the red corner is the winner.
Well, in the end, rather unlucky for young Des Mooney, but really, I don't think there was any doubt that Dennis Oakes of Liverpool was on his way to a fairly emphatic win. Mooney retiring with a damaged hand at the end of round two. That puts Liverpool 3-2 up.
Well done, Dan. This is, by the way, this is Henry Cubitt.
Yeah. Well done, son. Congratulations. Well done.
Well, Mr. Oakes seems a sensible enough boxing father, doesn't he? Not like one or two we've met in our time, eh, Henry?
Well, I've just been reading a notice which is up on the wall in the club here, and it's basically what it says is, would a parent not interfere on training nights with the trainer and the boxers? And I think that's a very good thing, because over the years, you know, I've seen father-son relationships in boxing, and I always think they either go two ways. The father thinks that the son is so good and he'll overmatch him and put him in and get the poor so-and-so a belting, or they go right the reverse, where they think that the kid is not as good and they wrap him up in cotton wool and the kid never seems to progress. So I think it's a good thing if fathers, parents especially, keep out of their sons' training methods, and I think that's a very good thing. I mean, when I was a kid, you know, the father's done a little bit and he's got the son who's interested in it, and the kid perhaps is not interested. He thinks the kid's interested in it, and the kid hates what he's doing. He's never going to get on because he just doesn't like what he's doing. He hasn't got his heart in it. No, I think it's good for parents to have keenness with their sons and interest in what their son's doing. I mean, one thing with me, thank God, you know, my father was an amateur boxer and boxed one or two professional fights. He was always interested in watching me and always came and watched me, but he never interfered, and I always thank him for that, because that was a good thing in my mind.
And in a couple of moments, we'll be seeing a boy from the last series, 18-year-old Alan Bond from Birmingham, and his father,
bring him up, Al, bring him up,
is always there to encourage.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next contest is a 57 and a half kilo contest, three rounds, 2 minutes each round, between, in the red corner, John Daly, Liverpool. And in the blue corner, Alan Bond, Birmingham.
And Alan Bond's father, David, then, sitting at ringside. Neither of these lads, it would seem, has a job. Maybe that's why John Daly, wearing the red of Liverpool, wants to be a professional. Alan Bond, the Birmingham boy, of course, in the all-blue strip. Remember, Liverpool lead by 3-2. So quite a lot depending on Alan Bond. But I'm sure I don't need to tell you, Liverpool has produced even more boxing champions than Liverpool have won Division One titles. A really great fighting city. Some of these youngsters tonight, maybe the future amateur and professional stars of the future. Certainly one or two of the lads from the first series have gone on to good things since they made their television debuts in 1983. Back in the ring meanwhile, more fast and furious action. Alan Bond of Birmingham in blue, John Daly of Liverpool in red.
How do you think Alan done in that round?
Well, I don't think he went too bad.
Yeah. He looks as though he's come up against a useful boy there in the Liverpool lad, don't you think?
Bad.
Yeah, yeah. So it's a fairly close round there. How did you think it went?
I'll say close.
Yeah,
same
yeah,
as
yeah.
Use the left hook into the body as hard as you can.
So, well, we'll have to see how he does in these first next two rounds,
that's
eh?
It. He'll win.
Yeah, that's it. Lovely. Nice and common.
Take your time. OK, let's go.
The start of the second, then, between this young man, Alan Bond of Birmingham, in the old blue strip, John Daly of Liverpool in red, and Bond, for me, with a little bit of leeway to make up, and by the way he started the second, I think he realises that too. Both these youngsters, vastly experienced. Bond is 18, Daly 17, but he's going to be 18 in just a few days' time on April the 4th. Daly's had 60 bouts, and Alan Bond 47. And believe me, they've won far, far more than they've lost, both of them. Once again, Keith Everson, the referee. Both boys trying to work at close quarters. The head's getting a little bit too close for comfort. To punch with the knuckle part of the glove. And what a good right hand that was. Both these two lads tending to rush in a little bit wildly rather than using the jab to look for openings.
Keep the same work rate going all the time. Hooks to the body, head, when he goes against the ropes, when he comes back off the ropes, catch him with that right as hard as you can.
He's got a useful punch in that right uppercut, hasn't he?
Yes.
Has he been practicing that, do you know, lately? Or?
I think his older brother teaches him, Richard.
Oh, yeah, obviously you've got another son who boxes, do you?
Yeah, Richard Bond. He's in the IBIs today, like.
Oh, is he? Yeah, yeah. So he's been getting him together with that right uppercut. Yeah. Have you got quite a bit of success with that in that round there?
Oh, he's stingy with it.
What you're doing, just a little bit more, OK? This man on, the last 2 minutes. That jab's the winner for you. Come on. OK? This is it.
Well, John Daly's trainer maintaining everything depending on the last 2 minutes. Once again, I find it hard to disagree with that statement. John Daly of Liverpool in red, Alan Bond of Birmingham in blue. Daly's the more experienced boy, but Bond's certainly trying to take the fight to him. A little bit wild, remains to see how the judges will react. And once again, this really is going to be a difficult fight for the judges to score, because we haven't seen any really clear-cut punching. A lot of the action's been at close quarters. Both boys have been called, as Bond was just then. And it'll be down to the judges to try and find a winner. Well, Daly in a little bit of danger going through the ropes. Referee Keith Everson spots the danger, pulls him back to the middle of the ring. But Bond will not be denied, powering his way in then. That's the bell for the end of the third. And what a good contest that was, wasn't it? And, well, I think Alan Bond might just have made it 3-3 with that display.
So, how do you think that's gone?
I reckon he won it.
Well, it's going to be interesting to see where the referee the judges
the
yeah, the majority, yeah, I think. Well, I kind of agree with you there.
Here comes the verdict.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner by a majority decision, Daly in the red corner.
I thought he got it one, but that's a judge, isn't it?
Disappointed,
Robert. No, not really.
No,
no, that's disappointing.
Why do you think you didn't get the decision?
Well, I don't know, like, yeah, we boxed before, like, and I got the decision then, like, so it's equal now, like, but
probably because I think I'm clear now.
George is at a mark in that, isn't he?
Yeah. I have the final word.
Still, that's how it goes.
It was a nice fight and I enjoyed it. Like, I let the team down, but I enjoyed the fight.
Well, that just about sums up the sportsmanship of schoolboy boxing, doesn't it? Anyway, Liverpool 4-2 ahead then in this eight-bout quarter-final, but they could still be beaten if Birmingham can win these last two contests and finish up with the more unanimous decisions. This now the first of those contests, bringing together two lads who've done pretty well in schoolboy and junior ABA events, Sean Cogan of Birmingham and Kevin Mason of Liverpool. Both these lads 16 years old, Mason still at school, Cogan sadly one of the unemployed youngsters on show tonight. And Birmingham with a lot of leeway to make up. So a lot depending on Sean Cogan, who's already picked up a nosebleed. Well, referee Keith Everson stops the contest. And that is a record stoppage.
What's wrong with him?
And
doctor, pass that.
The medical safeguards in schoolboy boxing, very strict.
The doctor passed him once.
And just how strict can be seen from that stoppage. Sean Cogan, very unhappy about that. But as far as he's concerned, the evening is over.
Sorry,
I don't think Kevin Mason can have expected a win as easy as that in a million years. So rather fortunate young Liverpudlian, Kevin Mason. But a great deal of sympathy for his opponent, Sean Cogan, who scarcely lasted a minute of this fight.
The referee stopped the contest. Cogan in the blue corner sustained a badly damaged eye.
So it wasn't the nose after all, then. In fact, the moment Cogan turned round, we could see that very bad swelling over his eye. A good decision, then. Now, Henry's with Maurice Hope again. It's nostalgia time. Henry, we all know, has vivid memories of his amateur days, and I'm sure that Maurice has.
Sure, in fact, there is a few memories there. That was when I went to the old Repton Club to join in the beginning. It shows me the difference, how the world has changed today. In those days, things was really hard, especially if you're a black man trying to, you know, progress in life. I remember the first day I went there to join the boxing club. They took me upstairs. I got stripped off everything. Got into the ring, shadow box, skipping, and, you know, groundwork. When I finished, I went downstairs like everybody else in the show. Well, in fact, I thought, you know, I was like everybody else. Yeah, but, cool. You know, fortunate for me, like I wasn't allowed to have the same showers with the white fellas. And of course, I was spared everything. But I think those are one of the things that made me a better fighter, you know, in order to get recognition and a place in society. With respect. Those were the days, really. Yeah. But yeah, it doesn't happen anymore, of course, today. Yeah, it's a different thing altogether.
But the bad old days.
The bad old days. But it was a good experience for me. It really made me, you know, toughen up. Made me a man.
And a very nice one too, Maurice Hope. And from him to Liverpool, now through to the semi-finals. The last bout now, Martin Robinson for Birmingham and Dominic Bilby for Liverpool. And we're in round one. Robinson, the boy in blue, he's studying to be a groundsman. Bilby, in red, is still at school. And if any of you are still just a bit baffled as to how amateur boxing is scored and how the three judges are scoring this bout, they each award 20 points to the winner of every round, of course. Well, Henry is sitting with one of those judges, Tony Matthews.
Well, can I ask you how you scored that one?
Well, I scored that 20 to red, and the reason red was punching absolutely correctly. He was putting the weight of his body behind it, and he was landing on the target area. Now, the blue boy was evading quite a lot of these blows, and he was doing very, very well. But the red just shaded the round, and so therefore I marked him down as to win by... He just lost one by one point.
Yeah. And I suppose That's why you've got the white flash on the gloves, is which helps you to detect the nothing
exactly,
part of that glove.
Exactly, yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. Because this is absolutely true. If they are swinging and the inside of the glove, you can then see the white showing and you know it's a foul blow.
Familiar face there, former world flyweight champion Charlie Magri, who learned his boxing here at the Arbor Youth Club. He's enjoying this final bout of the evening. Round two then between Martin Robinson in blue and Dominic Bilby in red. And you never know, Bilby could be a leading candidate for the Best Young Boxer of the Night award. He's avoiding Robinson's punch as well, is Philby. I'm getting that jab working very nicely, thank you. Leads with a right for a change. And then goes back to orthodox. Just sticking out the left.
So can I show you scored that round?
Yes, again, I scored that exactly the same. Mm-hmm. And although it was very, very close, I gave it to Red for the same thing. He was scoring correctly.
Mm-hmm.
Although on one or two occasions you will notice he was slapping, he was still scoring on the target area.
So I thought, just watching that round, I thought the blue boy perhaps forced it a little bit more in that round.
He did. He was coming back quite a lot in that round. But again, he on several occasions was hitting the inside of the glove. And so therefore I just shaded him out of it again.
So that would only influence you, with the boy who, say, does most of the attacking, that would only influence you if basically they were on level, on skill, and punching, punching correctly and all this, that, and that.
First of all, the punching, correct punching is the first.
Dominic Bilby then 2 points ahead on Judge Tony Matthews' card, 2019-2019. Going into round three. Incidentally, 2019, a very common score in amateur boxing. Well, Robinson caught with a left hander there, a little bit of distress, recovers himself well. And no doubt at all in my mind that Bilby coasting to what should be a pretty emphatic points win. The bell for the end of the third and final round, and anything other than a Bilby win would be an enormous surprise, to be honest with you.
So can I ask you once again, how did you score that round?
I scored that again to Red, and the reason being, as you saw yourself, he was more aggressive at the beginning of the round. Although the blue boy came back in the second round, in that round, Red kept on the top pretty well all the way through.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner by a unanimous decision, Bilby in the red corner.
Tony Matthews, two fellow judges then, obviously agreeing with him. And so, in this third quarter-final of Henry Cooper's Golden Belt, Liverpool have triumphed by 6-2. And they go forward now to join North London and Manchester in the semi-finals.
Henry, busy here signing certificates for every boy who's taken part tonight. We've still got one more award to make, though, and that's the special award given by Henry to the best young boxer of the night. So, Henry, who is going to be the lucky winner of tonight's award?
Well, a tough decision again, but I've given it to the boy in the last contest, Dominic Bilby. I think, he boxed well under pressure, because the Birmingham boy pressured him most of the time. He kept his cool. I thought he boxed pretty good, so I'm going to give it to him.
Congratulations. The awards for the evening all made then, and Liverpool defeat last year's runners-up Birmingham and go through to the semi-finals, along with Manchester, the defending champions, and the lads from North London as well.
One more team to join them, and we're going to find out who that's going to be next week when Newcastle meet Belfast. Till then, from me, it's good night, and from here,
fourth round!
time.
Tonight, back here at the Wall's End Boys Club, we've got Newcastle versus Belfast.
Representing Newcastle Boys Club's Alan McCaffrey. And in the blue corner, representing Belfast Boys Club's William Doherty.
Well, lots of partisanship here tonight, of course. And I think if the match is as good as it was the last time Newcastle met Belfast, we're in for a real cliffhanger.
You're absolutely right there, Henry. Yes, of course, these two teams met at the quarter-final stage of last year's competition, and what a cliffhanger they gave us. At one stage, Belfast were 4-1 up, then Newcastle pulled level at 4 apiece, so everything hinged on the final contest. It was between Sean O'Hanlon, the Belfast schoolboy in blue, Paul Hassan of Newcastle in red, and in round two, this is what happened.
Oh, what a good left hook from O'Hanlon. Down goes Hassan. What a good punch that was.
Well, that's how Belfast made it through to the semis last year, Henry. Yeah. Good punch, that. Do you see them doing the same again this year?
Well, I don't know. It could be a little bit different, you know. I mean, the Newcastle team at home here in a lovely hall like this with a great atmosphere. I mean, this atmosphere could lift them. It could be a different result.
Well, as Henry says, just one quarter-final place to be decided, either Newcastle or Belfast. Just let me refresh your memories. We've already got three teams through to the semi-finals. That's North London, Manchester, the defending champions, and Liverpool. Either Newcastle or Belfast tonight are going to join them. We've got some really great action for you, all the very best of boys' club boxing encapsulated into the next hour. I don't doubt we might be seeing one or two champions of the future. The first boxers, the first bout, already in the ring.
Well, a couple of fiery little redheads get the fourth quarter final in the Henry Cooper's Golden Belt Series off to a start. In the blue of Belfast, William, or Liam as he prefers to be known, Liam Doherty. And in the red of Newcastle, Alan McCaffrey. Alan's 14 years old, Liam 15 on the 22nd of April. And of course, Newcastle on home turf tonight. So a lot of home support for them. Well, two remarkably composed youngsters in the ring at the moment. McCaffrey of Newcastle in red, Doherty of Belfast in blue. Landing a nice overarm right there. These little lads weigh 40 kilos. That's about 6'4". Oh, and there's the best punch so far as the first round ends, and it was thrown by Liam Doherty.
Double left hand, a right hand and a left hook, OK? Double left hand, a right hand and a left hook. Don't stand back from him, OK? Now, saddle down, saddle down.
Let him bleed you and then hit him. You're boxing normally. Straight jab, the right hand's dropped.
And a lot of local vocal support heralds round two. And young Doherty, although he shaded that first round in my book, doesn't exactly come here tonight on a winning streak. Had 19 contests so far and lost 10 of them. McCaffrey, though he's much more experienced, 35 contests, he's got a similar record percentage-wise, won 17 and lost 18. Certainly plenty of support for young Alan McCaffrey here tonight. And referee Tommy Seymour very sensibly just keeping a watching brief and letting these two boys get on with it. There's the bell for the end of the second session.
All right. Oh, beautiful. Same again, but a little bit more aggression. And don't throw the right hand. Bang! Then I'll bang you mixing it. Don't mix it. Go in. 1-2 out. 1-2-1 out.
He won this one.
Second time.
Put him on a cash on it.
Well, I agree with both cornermen. It's all on this third and final round. And considering the tender years of these youngsters, a pretty skillful contest getting this fourth quarter final off to a start. We've certainly seen many worse bouts in the Golden Belt so far this year. A word to the corner there, telling them not to coach. That, of course, prohibited in amateur boxing as well as professional boxing. Well, the Belfast boy, Liam Doherty, finishing slightly the stronger. I don't know if you agree with me, but I think he may well just possibly be shading this bout. Well, then again, Alan McCaffrey showing really very nice skills for a lad of only 14. The bell for the end of the third, and as bright a show opener as I think you could wish.
I know, I think you keep the gloves on, and then keep the gloves on.
How did it feel?
Referee Tommy Seymour conferring with our MC Keith Darlow. And now we're going to get the result.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of that contest by a majority decision, McCaffrey in the red corner.
So Alan McCaffrey, the little Geordie, gets the hometown team, Newcastle, off to a winning start.
The judges scored the contest 59-58, 60-57, and 57-60.
Well, strangely inconsistent scoring as we move on to the next contest in this nine-bout quarter-final. For Newcastle, Thomas Pringle from Blythetown. And for Belfast, Eddie Fisher from the Holy Trinity Club. And the referee again is Tommy Seymour. So we're into round one then between the Belfast boy, Eddie Fisher in blue, and Thomas Pringle of Newcastle in red. Both these boys, 14 years old. And although neither appeared in the 5-4 Belfast win in the quarter-final last season, Tommy Pringle's brother did all right. That was brother John, who lost on a second-round stoppage to the Irish boy Cole McParland. So, young Pringle fighting for a bit of family honour tonight. But the Belfast boy, Eddie Fisher, looking pretty businesslike in this opening round. Owen caught with a good left-hander there was young Tommy Pringle of Newcastle. Oh, and he doesn't know what day of the week it is. And referee Tommy Seymour not even bothering to take the count up. As the saying goes, it's Saturday and you're in Newcastle and you've just lost. And once that left and right hand landed, poor Tommy just didn't know what day it was. Well, our medical officer tonight, Dr. McKeith, is having a quick word
Ladies
with
and gentlemen,
Tommy Pringle.
The referee has stopped the contest. Fisher is the winner.
Okay,
you manage
your way there. Be all right. Well, a round of sympathetic applause as 14-year-old Tommy Pringle leaves the ring, still a little bit groggy, but he was caught with an awfully good punch. Now, the ABA take great care over any boy who's been stopped or knocked out, and that result will be entered on young Tommy's personal record card.
Well, we've just seen the lad go off, but I think he's going to be all right because he'll be well looked after, and he won't box now for at least another 28 days. But now, I have my special guest of the week, John Stracey, former World Welterweight Champion. John, now, if there was one bit of advice you had to give, well, any one of these boxers you've seen tonight, what would that be, do you think?
Well, first of all, I think everyone boxed exceptionally well this evening anyway, and they probably all know what they like doing their training. But my special one was always sparring.
Mm-hmm.
I think mainly because I could never get going in the gym unless I sparred, say, 4, 6, maybe 8 rounds.
Yeah.
And for the big fights, the championship fights, always had 2 or 3 15-rounders for 2 or 3 weeks before, and then come down slowly. So I think sparring in general.
Well, that's strange. I mean, I hated all that amount of sparring. I wouldn't have done, you know, I used to read in the papers fighters doing, you know, 100 rounds of sparring. I mean, I couldn't have done that. I'd have been well over the top by fight night came. It's funny how fighters differ, don't they? Yeah, they're all different animals.
Oh, I loved it. Yeah. I think sparring's essential. I think that's the main thing for boxers.
Yeah. John, did your trainers in training try to make you do things that you didn't want to do?
Well, I was never a lover of speedball work. I didn't have fast enough hands, actually.
Yeah, yeah.
And bag work I detested because I always thought you're hitting a dead body.
Yeah.
And my main stable diet was sparring. Yeah. I couldn't train unless I sparred.
Well, John, you won your world title in Mexico City. Now, was there any special problems out there with your training?
Well, there were special problems, but we went out there a month before and we took very great precautions, altitude training, fast running sprints, breathing apparatus. And by the time the fight came, it was just like being in Bethnal Green.
Was it?
No. Fantastic.
Anyway, lovely to have you on your programme, John. It's lovely to see you looking so well.
Thank you very much.
And from Mexico to Bethnal Green and to Newcastle, back in the ring, the match score 1-1. Boys clubs, John Summers. Aged 14, he's had 27 bouts and he's won 20 of them.
And in the blue corner, representing Belfast Boys Club's Martin McCusker.
And Martin is 15 Summers and red, slightly McCusker the more experienced. The start of the first round then between John Summers of Newcastle in red, Martin McCusker of Belfast in blue. And as you can see instantly, young John Summers of Southpaw. John not hanging about, is it? A right-hander has McCusker on the canvas, compulsory count of 8. Box on, and this isn't going to last too much longer. That's it, all over. Well, poor Martin McCusker caught a bit of a tiger there. And referee Sid Wilson, after administering the standing count of 8, lets the fight go on. And mercifully, it only continued a few more seconds. So, two lightning results there. First of all, we had Eddie Fisher winning in a round for Belfast, and then John Summers doing exactly the same thing for Newcastle.
Yes, Dave, you've noticed Martin under pressure there, covering up against the ropes, and he pushes his left hand out blindly, leaving his chin completely open to that right hook. You won't do that again, will you, Martin?
Well, John, I think that's one of the quickest wins we've ever had in the Golden Belt. Did you go out there with the intention of finishing it as quickly as you did?
I didn't think I would finish it that quick, but I always wanted to go out and finish it, you know.
Well, it was a lovely right-hander you caught Martin with that put him down first. You must have realised then that the fight wouldn't go on too long.
I wasn't too sure. I think I caught him with a body shot first, then followed up with a right hook. It was a good punch, and I think he was a good boxer.
Have you got a reputation of being a bit of a banger, then?
No, not really. Usually go the distance.
Well, Martin, the referee stopped your bout in the first round, though. Well, what happened?
Well, they got my body punch to her ribs, like, and hurt my right.
Yeah, that was a body punch that had done the damage, was it, yeah? Oh. What, it just winged you?
And then he hit me on the chin, like.
Well, don't worry about it, because, you know, I had one or two on the whiskers and didn't get up from him, you know, so it happens to the best, you know. All the greats have been knocked out and been stopped, so just, you know, train hard and keep at it, and you'll make the great, OK?
Yeah.
Cheers.
Right.
It's put Newcastle right back in it, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Any predictions how it's going to turn out? Because Belfast boys beat you 5-4 last year.
I hope we slaughter them this year.
Any more like that, and I think they will. Thank you very much, John.
Yeah, right. Thank you.
Well, the Belfast team, I'm sure, equally determined to repeat last year's win.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next bout is a 55-kilogram contest. 2 rounds of 1.5 minutes and 1 round of 2 minutes. Between and introducing, in the red corner, representing Newcastle Boys Club's Chris Wright.
He boxes for St Kilda's in Jarrow and a semi-finalist in this year's Boys Club's National Championships.
And in the blue corner, representing Belfast Boys Club's Sean Duffy.
and Sean's the Ulster champion in his class, and both boys are 15. The first round then between Chris Wright of Newcastle in red, Sean Duffy of Belfast in blue, and if the last two bouts we've seen have been anything to go by, don't leave your seat or you might well miss this one. Chris Wright boxed in the Golden Belt last year, and he lost on points to Mick McCambley of Belfast, but looks pretty useful tonight. And neither of these two boys hanging about, are they? First round continuing momentarily into the break, but that purely accidental on Chris Wright's part.
Something wrong,
take it, yes. Don't mix him. Hit him to the head and then straight right to the body. Your right hand slow the head. Woof.
Use your left hand, your right hand, and your left hook. Now even feint them with a the left hand and use your right hand and your left hook. You understand that? Here we go now. Come on, please first.
Round two then between Sean Duffy of Belfast in blue, Chris Wright of Newcastle in red. Getting his jab working well now is Chris Wright. Chris's mum and dad here at ringside tonight.
Oh, excellent jab!
Referee has a word with the boys. A word of comfort from me to Mrs. Wright. I reckon Chris is getting on top. And he's getting caught rather too often for his liking, is Sean Duffy. Chris Wright certainly giving it everything he's got in this second session. Looking for the opening, the Newcastle boy. He's not wasting a punch. That's good to see an amateur boxer. There's the bell for the end of the second.
Now, you must go forward this round. You must use that left hand.
Boxing beautiful, sir. Lovely.
This is your last round, and you'll have to catch him. You settle down. You throw your left, your right hand will come, and then your hook will come. And both to it.
The third and final round then between Chris Wright of Newcastle in red, Sean Duffy of Belfast in blue, and it's Wright that has the upper hand. Pretty even in the first round, but Wright got his act together in the second, scored well. Let me remind you at this early stage, the usual weekly award for the best young boxer, and, well, Chris Wright getting his name down on the candidates list pretty early. Oh, now what nice defensive skills. Of course, the Newcastle team as a whole have a score to settle, beaten 5-4. Everything hinging on the final bout last year, as it turned out. Wright getting caught there with a left-hander from Duffy. Can't afford to get too cocky. We've already seen two stoppage results already tonight. There's the bell, and a sparkling contest that was. And Henry Cooper, I see, having a word with Chris Wright's dad.
Well, great bout that. I mean, the public's brought the place down. How do you think it's gone?
I think so, yeah.
Uh-huh.
It's nervous all round, you know, nervous for myself and the wife.
So who do you think's won it, then?
Well, don't want to be biased, but I think my boy, you know.
You mean Chris,
I think
that.
My boy.
Let me ask the wife. I think she's ate all her nails away here. Have you got any fingernails left, Bob?
Well, a few.
How do you think he's done?
I think he's won, Lee.
What's he like at home? Is he a moody boy? I mean, is he upset if he loses, or...?
No.
No?
No,
he takes it all in good, are they?
Yeah.
Yeah? Oh, good. So, Well, this must be nerve-wracking time for you and for him, I suppose.
It is a long time since I've seen him box, Lee.
Is it? Oh, you don't come every time,
do you? No, just when he's locally.
Well, here comes the verdict from MC Keith Darlow, but I don't think there can be too many doubts as to who's won.
The winner of that contest, by a unanimous decision, right in the red corner.
Wow!
Oh, there's an happy mother for you. Can't be bad. Yeah.
Well, as you've seen, I've been doing one or two interviews with mums and dads sitting around ringside, and I think it's lovely, you know, to see mums and dads giving their boys encouragement. I always got that from my mum and dad, but I was rather pleased that Dad didn't want to come in the gym and actually get involved in my training, because it's no good to say a father training a son, which I was pleased in the long run my father never did. But mum, you know, used to come and watch us box, and my mum, you know, she used to love it when we were little, when we were tiddlers, you know, near eye to a grasshopper. She used to love it because she knew we wasn't hurting ourselves. But then as we got older and we got up into about the 10 stone and 11 stone mark, she didn't like it and she stayed away, and she just couldn't bear it, because she was very much like my wife, you know. When we were boxing professionally, she never watched us box professionally. She was chewing her nails, and I think she chewed them up to her elbows at times. So in one way, I think it's good to give your children encouragement, but not to get too involved and so involved where you affect their performance.
Well, there's plenty of encouragement for the lads tonight. It's bout number five now. Liam Riley boxing in blue for Belfast against Stephen Taylor for Newcastle in red. We're in round two. The first round was pretty even. Newcastle leading 3-1, so the Irish boys really need to pull something out of the fire. And Liam Riley could be just the boy to do it. He's had 8 bouts and he's won the lot. Stephen Taylor's more experienced, although on the face of things, rather less successful. 25 fights, only 15 wins. Both these lads hold their guards up high. They look pretty stylish, don't they? End of round two, and I've got Taylor ahead on my card.
Keep going, keep jabbing, jab, jab, jab.
They get that jab on first, and that'll put him off. He falls off balance. Use the jab, put him off balance, and then hit him with your right. Now, you have a good right hand, you haven't used it yet.
Well, Liam Riley, the Belfast boy in blue, comes out for the third and final round with the advice of trainer Herbie Young in his ears. He's up against Stephen Taylor of Newcastle in red. And it's Taylor who very much has the upper hand. Well, he got tagged then. It was the left hand that did the damage.
Well, they're boxing on, Dave, but the advice from his corner was jab, jab, and Stephen did just that. He opened his opponent up with that left jab and finished with the right cross. Look, oh, wallop.
And Stephen Taylor looking for the finish now. May have left it a bit too late. Inexperience starting to show through here. He's had a quarter the number of contests that Stephen Taylor's had, and the Newcastle boy using that experience to the full. A knockdown in the third, there goes the bell, and I would think that knockdown sealed the win for Newcastle.
You worry about it beforehand and all that, you put yourself under pressure, and you dream of Matt Banner boys on that.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of that contest by a majority decision, Taylor in the red corner.
Well, heaven alone knows why it was only a majority decision, but justice is done. Stephen Taylor wins it, and Newcastle
the
now very firmly in the driving seat.
The contest.
The score 4-1, and just one more win would put 60, Newcastle through to the semis. So the Irish 59. Desperately need a win from their next boy.
You're banging the ring soon, aren't you?
Catch him, girls. St. Carcalior.
What was that?
Irish.
Irish?
Yes.
Oh, is this what they call, what, Gaelic?
Yes.
Oh, good. So, what, you, you're studying languages, are you?
Yes, I'm studying Irish at St. Malachy's College.
Oh, yeah.
Belfast.
Mm, marvellous. So what would you like to do then when you leave school?
I think I'd like to be either in banking or a lawyer.
Well, that's not a bad old business to be in, eh? You're starting off being a boxer, aren't you? You're going to banking.
Well, Belfast need all Patrick Fitzsimons' abilities tonight. His opponent is 16-year-old John Morris from Newcastle. The opening bell then between John Morris of Newcastle in red and Patrick Fitzsimons of Belfast in blue. And now we're due for another quick end. Oh, short on finesse, long on excitement. Both these boys 16. Simon's tagged with a right hand of that. That was young Morris's father. Well, lively opening session.
Pick your punches. As he's running in, he'll throw a left hand down the stairs, right? Keep walking. Don't get in there. Yeah.
Here we go then with the second round between Patrick Fitzsimons of Belfast in blue, John Morris of Newcastle in red. Irish boy studying for no fewer than 9-0 levels at the moment. And he says he wants to be either a lawyer or a banker. Let's ask him afterwards if I can borrow a quid off him. Caught the Newcastle boy, a couple of good shots there to the head. But John Morris fighting back well. So Newcastle obviously enjoying enormous home support. A crunching right hand then, gets through. Fitzsimons takes it well. Well, he can take a shot, this Irish boy, because Morris has landed a couple in this bout. And Fitzsimons has really just walked through them. Oh, he's a tough little character, this Patrick Fitzsimons. End of round two.
Well, how do you think John's doing so far?
Well, I think he's doing all right, and he, like, you know, and first round, like, wasn't too bad, but the second round, I think he done well, like.
Yeah,
you know?
I thought the first round, what, was fairly level, but he just seemed to pull ahead in that one, didn't he?
Yeah, in the second round, I think he put it back in the second round. Yeah. Like.
So have you come and watch him most times?
Oh, yeah, go all the time.
Yeah, you follow him around?
Follow all the way around with him and watch him all the time.
Lovely, yeah. And he enjoys it?
Oh, he thinks it's great.
Yeah, anyway, we'll watch and see how he does here.
OK, Danny.
Round three, then, between John Morris of Newcastle in red and Patrick Fitzsimons for Belfast in blue. And, but frankly, I think it's the Irish boy that's ahead. And it's contests like this that makes the judges task all the harder. A little bit of showmanship there from Fitzsimons. An early shuffle. And a cut now on John Morris's left cheek. That might have been caused by heads. Well, I think Fitzsimons might have got that. Right. Might be a majority decision, but I think he's got it.
Well, it was a tough scrap.
Yes, it was a really good fight. I think it was well matched. Henry Lake.
Three good rounds.
Three good rounds, and I think
I think he may have just got thrown on the last one.
And how does Willis' mum think of him boxing?
Well, she likes him boxing, but she doesn't like to see him get hurt. He wouldn't let her come tonight.
Oh, he wouldn't let
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of that contest by a unanimous decision, Fitzsimmons in the blue corner.
Well, he's got it, and Belfast are coming back. Newcastle now lead by 4-2.
Yeah.
I must say, it surprises me a little. I thought your boy had just done clubs enough to win.
Yeah, I thought he had just
There was a lot in it, that's for sure.
The judges scored the contest 58-59, 58-60, 57-60.
Well, I thought that was a lovely little touch. Look at that. You've got the loser coming all the way to the winner's dressing room just to congratulate him and shake hands with him. Now, that's what the spirit we love to see in amateur boxing, and that's what basically boys' club boxing's all about. That's marvellous. Now, I watched about, and the only thing is, perhaps you were leaving yourself open as you were coming. I think you've got to watch how you're coming. You mustn't jump in, and you've got to still be balanced. You know, you was a little bit off balance as you was getting a bit excited, you know, trying to get in there a bit quick to, you know, get in these reins. So try to keep balance nicely all the time, and then you'll be okay. And keep a moving target when you meet those big tall guys, isn't you? Keep moving. Anyway, you've done very well. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Well, John, hello. I've come to see you in your dressing room. Yeah, that was a nice little touch there. And did you think the bout went?
Yeah, I thought he was a very tough opponent. Yeah. Very strong puncher. Yeah, so all I mean, it was close, very close.
Yeah, it was very close, because I was sitting with your dad, and I thought perhaps, we all thought perhaps you might have done enough just to nick it, but anyway, that's how it goes. But I think, when you fight opponents like that, or box opponents like that, let's put it that way, in the amateur game, I think, you know, what you've got to do is, you know, you're nice and tall for your weight and your age, and you've got to make good use of that long reach and the height, you know, and you wasn't there, because you were letting that little guy get to inside. You and get inside, so get on the old trombone left going, and, you know,
away from
dominate the fight from the centre ring, make them little guys move around you.
Yeah.
And apart from that, you'll be all right, mate.
Hey, thanks.
Okay, from a fine sporting loser to the next bout already in the ring. For Belfast, Charlie Brown. For Newcastle, Martin Henderson. And both boys are 16. The match score then, Belfast 2, Newcastle 4. And could we possibly be in for a finish like last year? Round two then between Martin Henderson of Newcastle in red, Charlie Brown of Belfast in blue. Now Henderson was pretty inconvenienced by some excellent body punching that Brown put in the first round. Got a nosebleed for his efforts as well, did young Martin Henderson. And that nose has started up again. You don't often see body punching in boys' clubs. They mainly go head-hunting, but very effective Brown's attacks. You can see Henderson trying to cover up. He's got no real defence. He's taking some of those shots on his arms, but as we've already pointed out, quite a lot more are getting through. Henderson's training to be a painter and decorator, but it rather looks as though he's been practising on his own arms, doesn't it? Henderson's ribs are going to be pretty sore in the morning, taking quite a pounding. Yeah, that's a good right hand of his own there. Well, it's Brown's left that's doing the damage. And once again, I would think Henderson's pretty relieved to hear the bell for the end of round two.
Haven't missed him with a jab, man. Use the jab, Charlie. On your right hand, on your hooks. Okay. This is your aim, man. Get out there. Use the jab first. On your feet, Charlie. Okay.
One strike. That's it. The bell signals the start of the third and final round then between Charlie Brown of Belfast in blue, Martin Henderson of Newcastle in red. And the feature of this contest so far has been Charlie Brown's body punching, which has really been quite outstanding. Still, Henderson not out of it yet. Really good, strong last round. Might swing the fight in his favour, but not if he has to take many more standing counts of eight like that. That left hand of Brown that's caused him so many problems, getting through again on the side of the jaw, down for a count of eight. Charlie Brown, as he's been doing right from the off, dictating this fight. And I would think he'd be a pretty strong candidate for the Best Young Boxer of the Night award. There's the bell. Smiles all round. That's after all what Boys Club Boxing is all about. And I think that Charlie Brown could have put Belfast right back into this quarter-final with a vengeance. Well, here comes the verdict from
ladies and gentlemen,
RMC, Keith
the Darlow. Result of that contest by a unanimous decision, Brown in the blue corner.
So Charlie Brown does notch up his 17th win from 19 bouts, and Belfast creep closer. The match score now, Belfast 3, Newcastle 4, and what a finish in prospect. Join us in just a moment. Welcome back, and let's rejoin Henry with tonight's special guest, John H. Tracy.
This must bring back memories to you, surely.
Very much so, yes. I won the National Association of Boys Clubs Championships way back in 1966, and would you believe it, I was a mere 7'7".
What, ringing wet that was?
Class A, 15 I was, and thoroughly enjoyed it. I think that this type of boxing is a future stock for our country, for perhaps good amateurs and professional. I won the ABA Championship, and I also went to Mexico City in 1968 at the age of 18, and lost the eventual gold medalist, but give him a shiner.
Well, that's a coincidence. So you went to the Olympics in Mexico City and you won your world title as a professional.
That's right, yes. In, and a funny story, actually. I went to a ball ring in 1968 in Mexico, the first one I ever went to, and swore that I'd never go to another ball ring. And believe it or not, in 1975, I boxed in the same ball ring for the championship of the world.
Well, after your boys' club boxing, you went on, what, to bigger and better things in the amateur game?
Well, I won two junior ABA championships. And then when I was 18, I boxed in Mexico. And then I won the ABA Championships in 1969. But in 1968, in Manchester, I lost to Jim Watt.
Not the lightweight champion.
The lightweight champion. Yeah. Well, he stopped me in 45 seconds. Good. So if he wants to return, I'll put on a bit of weight, but I'll take him.
Well, we're into round two then between Alan McCulloch of Belfast. He's the lad in the all-blue strip. And in the old red strip of Newcastle is Philip Brooks. And the Newcastle boys starting to get on top now, but some good defensive work. That was special from Alan McCulloch. Dodging out of his own corner and then coming back with a good left-right combination. Nice to see that. These two boys both got a similar style. Well, that was the right hand that had Brooks down there. Short punch. That'll count well in McCulloch's favour. But Brooks fighting back like a good one. McCulloch's gun shield is gone. The end of round two then, and Philip Brooks, the Newcastle lad, has brought along his elder brother for support.
Well, what's it like for a brother watching his brother box?
Oh, it's fantastic. It's really great.
You enjoy it, yeah?
It's the first time I've seen him box. It's fantastic.
Your fortunes are swinging one way and then the other, aren't they?
I thought he had him there, but he came back.
Back, yeah.
Came back well.
Just seemed to be tying a little bit, and then he landed that big punch there.
I think he's hurt him a bit there. He's got him up. He's got him mad there now.
Oh.
Well, I fancy Alan McCulloch is leading, and win he must if Belfast are to stay alive in this quarter-final, with just one more bout to come. Well, McCulloch, the boy in blue from Belfast, just can't wait to get this third and final round started. He already holds a knockdown over Philip Brooks of Newcastle. That's the lad in red. Everything hinging on this third and final session, perhaps. But Brooks in trouble now. He's holding on, trying to hold on for all his worth. And the Belfast boy really putting everything into this final round. Brooks caught again with a good right-hander. He gets caught there with a right hand. Brooks showing his life in him yet. Belfast boy's taking this, no doubt about that. Although he misses with that left-hand swing. There's the bell. And referee Sid Wilson guides Alan McCulloch back to his corner.
Tell us some nice shots, sir. Always use that jab here. Good job. Every punch comes from that. Stop the nice tracks, all that thing going.
Well, Herbie Young in the Belfast corner, pretty pleased with his lad. Now, though, has
Ladies
Belfast
and gentlemen,
leveled the score?
The winner of that contest, by a unanimous decision, McCulloch in the blue corner.
Yes, they've done it. They've done it exactly the same as last year. The match is level and the perfect situation, all on the last bout now. And for Belfast, it's all on this lad.
Well, what a fighting comeback the Irish have made here. 4-4 now, how are you feeling?
Good chance now.
Yeah, you got your spirits high, eh? You think you got a chance, eh?
Well, he put my spirits up where they're winning. So
yeah. Now, how do you box? I mean, are you a boxer, are you a puncher, or how do you assess yourself?
I box out and fade a bit, so I do both, so I can't.
You can, you're a bit of a box puncher, eh? You're a pretty good mover?
Well.
So you fancy your chance, eh? You're going in there all...
Well, go and try my hardest, try and win.
That's it, that's all you can do in it in this game. So anyway, I won't keep you because I know you've got to get in the ring there. Good luck to you and all the very best.
Well, the rest of the Belfast team right behind Ronnie Kirk, but the home crowd equally determined. After eight excellent bouts, it all comes down to this. Ronnie Kirk of Belfast in blue, John Vickers of Newcastle in red. The winners are through to the semi-finals. Remember, 4-1 down at one stage, a pullback to four apiece. And Ronnie Kirk intends to see they go all the way. In fact, Ronnie Kirk likes boxing so much, he even helped found his own boxing club. The Ards Arena Room, with a boxing club in Newton Ards over there in Northern Ireland. This is a classic confrontation, slugger versus stylist. The boxing coming from John Vickers, the punching power from Ronnie Kirk. And Kirk it is who's gaining the ascendancy in this first round. There's the bell for the end of the first.
get it in there. Be first. Jab him off. Keep off the ropes and keep your hands up a little bit, right? Because you've won this all the way now. If you just do that, right? Use the jab. Right hand. And your left.
Well, it seems both corners think their boy is in the lead. Round two then between Ronnie Kirk of Belfast in blue, John Vickers of Newcastle in red. Newcastle boy got a little bit of leeway to make up. Vickers needed to do something in the second round because Kirk quite clearly took the first. And he's certainly giving it his best shot as the young Newcastle boy. Got Vickers in trouble on the race, but the Newcastle boy gets out of it well. John Vickers, a little cut appearing on the bridge of his nose. There's the bell for the end of the second session. One to go.
Pick down first two, but next year, gotta take us third. All right, now, you must take us third, Ken. All right?
You're fit as a fiddle, you can take this now, right? Okay, go in there. Dale's gonna fight as well as Newcastle, right? Go on.
The third and last round then in this fourth quarter final between Newcastle and Belfast. Ronnie Kirk, the Belfast boy in blue. John Vickers of Newcastle in red. Referee Tommy Seymour just having a look at the slight damage to the bridge of John Vickers' nose before he lets that third round get underway. Everything's in order though, I'm pleased to say. Kirk ahead on points, bleeding from the mouth. This is a tough contest. Oh, good left-hander there from Kirk. That got through to Vickers all right. Head jerk back. Oh, all of a sudden the Irish boy looks rocky. Can still go any way this contest. Ronnie Kirk looking a little bit distressed now, but he's coming back well. John Vickers still got his composure, needs to work though, not stand and pose. The crowd loving this. Or has John Vickers done enough in this last round? Looking for the opening. And he tags Kirk and does it well. Irish boy comes back, and now it's Vickers' turn to sway on the ropes. There's the bell, and the crowd on their feet applauding this really quite astonishingly good boys' club boxing contest. Well, who would you choose? John Vickers or Ronnie Kirk here, the Belfast boy? I wouldn't like to say. I've got a punch. I think the Belfast boy might have nicked it. Well, the waiting over. We're going to find out who's made it through to the semis.
The winner of that contest, by a majority decision,
close.
Kirk in the blue corner.
Belfast have got it.
The judges scored the contest 58, 59, 57, 60, 59, 58.
So Belfast through by 5 bouts to 4, an extraordinary comeback. They go through to the semi-finals.
just one more thing for us to do tonight. Henry Cooper up in the ring about to present his shield to the best young boxer of the night. So, Henry, who have you chosen?
Well, once again, it's my great pleasure to present this award, the top boxer of the evening. And as I say, the shows have been going on so marvellous, they get better every week as we go. It makes my job that much harder. Time of Henry Cooper's golden belt. And we're on home ground for last year's champions, Manchester. And we've got a marvellous atmosphere here tonight. Plenty of money.
That first bout in the first semi-final for Henry Cooper's Golden Belt 84. Nigel Wilkes, little Nigel Wilkes of Manchester, 15 years old. He's boxing in red. And Stephen Livingstone, taller by a head. He's boxing in the blue of Belfast. And we've already seen Nigel boxing once so far this year. And we know he's a real little terrier. Won his bout against South London in the quarter-finals. A majority points winner over Riley Williamson. And he's a real little terrier, this Manchester lad. Likes to work inside, burrowing away. But he's going to have a job on his hands tonight. The Belfast boy, who, as we can see, is a southpaw, right foot, right hand forward. Looks a cagey customer. And this is what Wilkes does best. Going in, all guns firing. There's the bell for the end of the first. And Wilkes aggressive. Round two then. And out come Nigel Wilkes of Manchester in red, Stephen Livingstone of Belfast in blue. The Belfast cornerman you saw there, and our familiar face, Herbie Young, the Belfast boys' chief second. Credit to the Manchester boy, he's not panicking, he's not flailing away. He's trying to pick his punches, trying to work out an opening for himself. It's good boxing for a lad of only 15. Referee Walter Skirrow almost getting tangled up in the action then. A quick word with a corner, not to coach. And Nigel Wilkes realises that he's got to step up his work rate a little bit if he's to make anything of this bout. Can't let the Irish boy dictate tactics. And he gets in with a good left then. And caught Livingstone flush on the side of his jaw. Starts the final round against Stephen Livingstone in blue for Belfast. Wilkes completely outreached by his southpaw opponent, really needs to keep this round at close quarters now. Well, when Wilkes gets inside, he's causing Livingstone a lot of bother, but the Irish boy beginning perhaps to wilt a little bit in this third and final session. Tad with the left hand of that wild right swing from Livingstone, misses by a mile. And this round could be swinging things in Wilkes' favour.
Contest by a unanimous decision, Wilkes in the red corner.
Wilkes has got it, and Manchester go one up. And Patrick McCafferty in blue for Belfast. And although he's only 13, Craig Murray's had 24 bouts and he's won 20 of them. McCafferty, as you can see, is a southpaw. He's been boxing since he was 9. The end of the first, not too then between Craig Murray in red for Manchester and Patrick McCafferty in the blue of Belfast. And a really good left from McCafferty then. That's certainly a scoring blow. And another. Murray fighting back well. but referee Walter Skiro warning him not to punch with the open glove. Murray, 13 years of age. Patrick McCafferty, he's 14. Well, it's those left-handers of McCafferty that are doing the damage. Round three then with Craig Murray, the Manchester boy in red. A lot of leeway to make up against Patrick McCafferty of Belfast in blue. Walter Skiro stops the action just for a moment. McCafferty, a trailing shoelace. The clock has, of course, stopped during this. And off we go again. We're in round three. Craig Murray, Manchester Red. Patrick McCafferty, Belfast Blue. And although it may look as though Murray is landing the majority of the punches, a lot of those punches with the inside of the glove and consequently not scoring. Irish boy backpedaling now, doing his best to keep out of trouble. I think he's won this. But Murray certainly coming on strong as the bell goes.
McCafferty in the ball.
Well, McCafferty's got it. Unanimous it is. Belfast back in the match. Round one. Sean Duffy boxed for Belfast in their quarter-final against Newcastle, but he lost on points to Chris Wright, whom Henry chose as the evening's top boxer. Well, it looks as though we've got a classic confrontation here between a boxer and a banger. Paul Tucker, the Manchester boy, nice-looking stylist. Sean Duffy, the Belfast kid. Well, we've seen him before. We know what sort of fighter he is. Now, Tucker does not look exactly the most robust young man in the world. Nice mover. But I have a feeling that if Duffy gets through and starts working at close... The start of the second then between Paul Tucker of Manchester in red, Sean Duffy of Belfast in blue. Oh, Duffy doesn't intend to let himself get outboxed tonight. He's a nice stylist, all right. Tucker, question is, can he take a shot? For that matter, can Duffy? Little Nigel Wilts trying to get his weight up a bit. Well, he's fighting well, Tucker. No doubt about that. Boxing well on the retreat, sticking out that left jab, trying to vary his punches. Duffy trying to take the fight to him. And then between Paul Tucker of Manchester in red and Sean Duffy of Belfast in blue. The boxer be the banger and everything to go for. When he gets caught, oh, and he gets rocked by a left-hander. That's going to be a standing count of eight for Paul Tucker. Now, has he blown it? Got a little bit careless there, dropped his guard, and that you cannot do against a young man as dangerous as Sean Duffy. I said earlier that he didn't look too robust, but he's in desperate trouble now. He's almost out on his feet, as Paul Tucker. Sean Duffy almost pushed him over there, staggered onto the ropes to Tucker. Good thing for him, this is the third round. I think he'll just get through it, but it's going to be a desperately close thing. Can hardly keep his guard up now. Tucker caught again. Referee Terry Cole keeping a very close eye on the proceedings. Duffy's getting tired now. But he's an open target now, is Tucker. And for him, the bell did not come one moment too soon. Between Tony Connellan boxing for Manchester in red and Sean Diamond in blue for Belfast. Well, last year, Sean was stopped by Darren Connellan. Now in brother Tony, he meets a boy who's been a National Boys Club champion, a junior ABA champion, and three times a National Schools champion, and who's lost only seven of 80-odd bouts. Yeah. The Irishman in the ring is nephew Sean Diamond. He's in blue against Manchester's Tony Connellan in red. And Manchester really looking to Tony Connellan to put them back on level terms in the semi-final. They beat Belfast 8-1 last year. It'll be a real upset if they go out tonight. Strongly fancied the Manchester boys to go all the way again this year. Well, one thing already apparent in this fight, Diamond's come on a bit from last year. Taking no chances against Connellan, trying to keep him at arm's length. He's got the reach advantage as Diamond, trying to use it. And you can see how well Connellan uses the ring. He's stalking Diamond. Round three then between Tony Connellan of Manchester in red, Sean Diamond of Belfast in blue. Diamond trying to get his jab working, but he gets caught with a good left and right there for his pains. Well, he's working well with his left, Diamond, but not doing too much with his right. Two were the first two right-hand punches that Diamond had thrown for about 35 seconds.
The winner of that contest by a unanimous decision, Connellan in the red corner.
Well, no surprise. 1-1 then between Jerry McBride of Manchester in red, Roger McKernan of Belfast in blue. Oh, I lost count of those left jabs, I don't know about you. I don't think Jerry McBride liked them much either. Oh, Roger McKernan, a very businesslike young man. Guard held high, very Corinthian. Both these boys 16. And McKernan really likes something out of an 1890s textbook. McBride trapped on the ropes above me. And McKernan gets a warning for heads. So, round two then between Roger McKernan in blue for Belfast and Jerry McBride in the red of Manchester. We saw McBride earlier in this series when he lost a majority points verdict against Paul Martin of South London. But it's McKernan's strength that's pulling the bout his way, despite that bloody nose he's collected. It's proof indeed that the traffic's not all one way. Once again, McBride's sash in danger of coming loose. McKernan's face in an awful mess now. I can assure you, nowhere near as bad as... The third round then, Jerry McBride in red, Roger McKernan, blue vest, red face. Blood you can see on McBride's scalp, not a cut there. That's the blood that's really streaming down from McKernan's nose at the moment. Well, as I say, it looks particularly gory, McKernan's face, but it really is just a nosebleed, nothing more serious than that. Don't forget, all these bouts very closely medically supervised. All doctors and officials at ringside appointed by the Amateur Boxing Association. Well, not for the squeamish, this one. That's for sure. Grandstand finish by McKernan. He's not letting that nose injury of his put him off his stride in the slightest. And McBride must be wondering what he's got to do to stop this Belfast boy. He's throwing some good punches, McBride, no doubt about that. All you've got to do is look at McKernan's face to realise it. But this Belfast boy tanking forward. He's not a pretty sight, but... Now, is this going to be able inside a round and put Manchester into the final? The Belfast boy would do a little bit better if he... Round two then between Carl Wally of Manchester in red, Darren Doherty of Belfast in blue. Doherty already taken a standing count of 8 in the first round. It's a little bit of leeway to make up. Wally 15 years of age. Doherty on the receiving end of that left-right combination there. He's 16. And another good left from Wally gets through. But you still get that feeling that one punch, and not necessarily from Wally, could settle it. Then between Carl Wally of Manchester in red and Darren Doherty of Belfast in blue. Doherty took a standing count in the first, you'll remember. And it's been real all-action stuff all the way. Maybe not the kind of bout to excite those interested in the skills of boxing, but real all-action stuff. Well, this has certainly got the crowd on its feet, this contest. Partisan crowd here at the Salford Lads Club, urging Manchester into their second successive final. Smear of blood under Wally's nose. Nothing serious, nothing... ...from Darren after that
Ladies
knockdown.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of that contest, by a unanimous decision, Wally in the red corner.
Yes, Wally...
Not quite a fight, did we? But so I'd like a pound for every round we...
Certainly used them to good effect. Rather better, I'm afraid, than the two boxers in the ring at this moment. Liam Riley in blue for Belfast and Darren Duff in red for Manchester. It's coming to the end of round three and it's been a mauling, holding bout throughout.
The winner of that contest by a unanimous decision, Duff in the red corner.
Sent between Paul Fennelly of Manchester in red, Alan McCulloch of Belfast in blue. And a pair of Golden Belt veterans, these two boys. Fennelly 18, McCulloch 19. It's the third of Golden Belt's appearance for the pair of them. And funnily enough, they have identical records as well. One lost one. Fennelly bleeding from the nose already, but it's a sight when he's in the ring we've rather grown used to. Fennelly got the Best Boxer of the Night award when Manchester beat Belfast by 8-1 in last season's semi-final. But he lost his only appearance this season, though, going down on a majority points decision to Dennis Middleton of South London. Round two then between Paul Fennelly of Manchester in red, Alan McCulloch of Belfast in blue. From two seasoned television performers. A really good scrap this. No little skill, a lot of excitement, good punches, and two perfectly matched boys. It'll be quite a coup for McCulloch if he manages to beat Fennelly. Fennelly's had roughly twice as many fights as he had. And of those 50 contests he's had, he's lost only about eight of them. And once again, that nosebleed of his looking much, much worse than it really is. Well, he was rocked there by McCulloch. He's got a really crisp left jab, the Irish boy. He's using it well. Golden rules, McCulloch just learned them. Don't stop in the middle of a round to put the gum shield back in, because if you do, someone is likely to punch you on the nose. Brad Alan McCulloch of Belfast in blue. And if the Belfast boy keeps up the skill and aggression he showed in the second, he's going to win this. There goes the gum shield. Terry Cole just chucks it back into the Belfast corner. Well, Fennelly on the attack in this third round, given a bit of a rocket by trainer Henry Finney during the break. Henry Cooper's going to be looking for the best young boxer of the night after this bout. And they can hardly hear the bell go.
The winner of that contest by a majority decision, Fennelly in the red. The judges score.